to the nest for more intimate chats with the lovebirds. Now, with more discussion about love, sex, and relationships, here are Drs. Chuck and JoAnn Bird.
Welcome back. And we are talking to Dr. Krista Bloom about dating success.
That's right.
That's right. So, Krista, welcome back.
Thank you.
Well, we were talking before, and I had another question for you. Is do you work with gay and lesbian clients as well, or just strictly heterosexual clients?
I sure do. I work with gay and lesbian clients, and also bisexual, bicurious, and even transgender individuals on dating. So it's really a mix, because really the principles are the same.
Right.
Even sure. though some of the cultures and subcultures may be a bit different. But we have a very large gay and lesbian population and transgender population down here in South Florida. So those clients do come to me for dating and relationship advice as well.
Which is great.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Which is great. And what are you noticing? What are singles, like we were saying, because it has changed, what are they looking for today? What are you seeing? Is it casual relationships or more long-term, you know, the hooking up versus the dating, or what we just realized, there's a new term, dating adjacent.
I see a lot of fast cycling serial monogamy, but it's just a lot faster than it might have been when I was growing up, where it's a matter of weeks or days rather than months. Mm-hmm. And so you have a large population of that. And then I also see some people that I just don't want to really get engaged in anything serious at all, and are just out there having fun or having more casual relationships and being okay just being alone and being a successful single on their own. And for those folks, I think that's great, because I think people have a lot more options now to be single and to be okay with being a bachelor or bachelorette. Being single, I think, is more of an option now, whereas, you know, in earlier generations, people had to get married and have these traditional relationships that they may not have wanted to have.
Exactly.
That's true.
And there is research out there to support that when couples wait and get married at a later age, the marriages tend to last longer. And I think it may be due to the fact that you do get to know yourself, know what you're looking for.
True.
But, you know, the longer you wait, you have more time with yourself to know what it is you're looking for, your values, more clarification, maybe.
Sure.
Just a thought.
Yeah, I think that can be true. And I also think that there's certain couples that I've worked with that met at a very young age and just really bonded and had a lot of really strong friendship and a lot of things in common, and they also do well.
Sure, yeah, so it can be both.
Because they can grow together and, you know, go through the different trials and tribulations together. So, yeah, that's true.
Exactly. So I think there's some merit to that, and the longevity in relationships depends on a lot of factors. And I think the similarities and the compatibilities are really, really important and often overlooked.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
There's that old saying of opposites attract, but I don't know that necessarily works very well in relationships.
Exactly. We often ask, you know, what was one of the things that attracted, you know, how'd you know?
Yeah.
And we hear couples say things. Seriously, some of the young couples, you know, they were hot. That was one of their decisions, or that the sex was good.
Right, and that's just one aspect, but it's very limiting. And
I don't like them, but, you know, that's it.
And I know you guys are familiar with David Steele, and he wrote Conscious Dating, which is just one of the best dating books out there.
Sure.
And he talks about all these traps that people get into, the sex trap and the love trap and all these other things. So if you take one aspect of a relationship, you just like someone for their looks or their money or the sex or the love, just a love feeling without any backup of, you know, whether you have an overlapping life that's going to work together and values and things. And when you get into one of those traps, you fall in, and then the rest of the stuff you just overlook. You just blind yourself, or you just say, well, it's enough that they're nice.
Exactly. And, you know, we were talking about the limerence period.
Sure.
What is that? You know, a lot of people ask, and we always have to explain, it's that beginning stage of a relationship.
Well, I think it's a there's part chemical reaction that goes on in people's brains and bodies, and all the endorphins are released, and
yes, oxytocin,
the oxytocin, the attachment hormone, and people are just, and there's the excitement of somebody new and something fresh, and I think that people get infatuated. It's more of an infatuation.
Oh, definitely.
And then when that period ends and all the, you know, cuddle hormone goes back to normal,
those
and all the
rose-colored glasses come off.
And then you're going, wow. What was
you're
I thinking?
Going, wow.
I didn't do that to Chuck. No. He's looking at me, so I just want to confirm that.
Reality. No, then reality sets in, and then all the other aspects come out, which is why I suggest the time frame, because you can have, you know, two months, or maybe it's a matter of days, months, weeks, months. But, you know, after 6 months or a year, there's a lot of routine, and you've been through the birthdays and the I like a year because you've been through the birthdays, the holidays, you've gotten to see their crazy family, they've gotten to see your crazy family.
That's right, the crazy family.
And, and you can see if you can live with that, getting to know in couples today, too, or singles, a lot of singles now have kids, so how's that all going to work, and how's the ex situation going to work, and there's just a lot of complications now with that.
Exactly.
With, you know, multiple marriages and things. So I think you have to really do a lot of time outside of the limerence phase to really know. But I think that it's a really fun part of any relationship, the excitement, the joy, and all that attraction and all that fun, gooey, fuzzy stuff.
Yes.
Exactly.
But it doesn't last like that forever for most people.
Exactly.
Well, speaking of the fun,
and the fuzz
part, we had a person ask a question on our shout box on our website.
Okay.
Talking about sex and dating. And he wanted to know, should you have sex on the first date?
Mm.
And how do you handle that?
I think unless you're out there just looking for sex as a sex date, and that's a need that you need to get met, if you're looking for a long-term relationship, my answer to that is always no.
Yeah, sure. I happen to agree with you on
that.
We do,
too.
Exactly. There is a difference between a hookup and really dating. Oh, of course, Russell the Love Muscle's in there putting his thumb down.
Sorry, Russell. I apologize.
But that's if you're clear, like you said, if you want to go and hook up, both people... The rules are stated. It's safer sex. You know, both know that that's what's happening. That may be different, but if you're out there dating, you're serious, like you're talking about, probably not a good idea.
Probably not a good idea. Mm-hmm. And if you're talking about, it may be different also for gay guys. They may be able to get away with that better in a lot of cases because of the subculture.
Mm-hmm.
But I think in the heterosexual, the woman is never going to be respected if she does sleep with the guy in the first date, if she has intercourse with him.
Right.
We're talking about that, you know, we're talking about general intercourse. If she has intercourse with him, she's not going to be respected.
Right.
Period. And I don't think there's any exception to that. And so she has to just know that going in, that there still are those beliefs. And somewhere in the back of his mind, the guy's wondering, who else, you know, has she had sex with on the first date, and who else is she dating? You know, and so
exactly.
There's so many complications. And, hey, if the chemistry is there, it doesn't mean you can't kiss on the first date. I'm a fan of that.
Yeah. Right, and there's all kinds of outer core stuff, rubbing, and you know what I mean? There's all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, you can hug or kiss the person and see if there's, you know, chemistry, if that's the way the evening's going.
Sure.
But I just don't recommend it.
Exactly. Great. Definitely. Thank you.
Well, we're talking with Dr. Krista Bloom, if you're just tuning in. What other dating tips could you offer to ensure success?
For the singles, yeah.
I think one of the things is start out light and easy. So start out with a coffee date or something short versus dinner, a movie, a show, a 5-hour evening. I don't think it has to be all that. I think I like a pre-date date, which is just a real nice brief meeting where you can see if there's, you know, some kind of chemistry, not only physical chemistry, but conversational chemistry, emotional chemistry. See if if you've got enough going on to actually spend more time with the person.
Could be more like maybe a coffee shop or
an
ice cream shop, something real brief and casual that would allow you to chat for a bit.
That's
and to see if there's some similarities. And the other tip would be keeping the conversation light. So not getting right into all your terrible, you know, war stories of relationships and gone awry.
Or nor do you sit with a clipboard and go over, these are my requirements, and interview the person
check.
Probably not a good idea.
And the other thing is, and that's really good, because I think, you know, you don't want to grill the person and put them off. I mean, you
exactly.
can weave your requirements into your conversations or put
right.
out more of who you are and what you're looking for
sure.
more casually, rather than saying, okay, so do you want to have a baby?
Great, you know? Check. You like marriage? Check.
Yeah.
And the Whoa. Next year? Exactly. You don't want
How
to do that.
How big should the Harry Winston be in your ideal proposal? You know?
Exactly. And we had another question on our shout box. It was...
And if you do have any questions
ahead.
I just want to say, give us a call at 1-866-826-1340. If you have any questions, just give us a call.
What's that other question that's
oh,
on
the
there?
Other question was... Hold on, it's on the scrolling.
Oh, it was...
How do you get the person to talk to you...
If they're shy.
If they're shy.
If that person they're with is shy, what do you do?
Do you have any tips for that?
Oh, absolutely. I think you can just ask them some questions. Like, easy questions are, hey, what do you like to do for fun? And where have you traveled that you've enjoyed? And things like that. Just keeping it, you know, do you like...
Hobbies,
or what's your hobbies? Do you like
right.
animals, or you start sharing, you know, something that you've done that you've liked, or a hobby that you have, and just find out who they are, because people's favorite topic is usually themselves.
I was going to say, get them to talk about themselves.
Yes.
That's usually pretty easy to talk about. Yeah.
And I like the idea you were talking about, the pre-date, because if that's still a barrier, and you know that, gosh, this is uncomfortable, this doesn't feel right, the chemistry's not there, it's short, sweet, that's it. You don't
yeah,
have to
I mean,
spend hours.
I've had dates personally that lasted less than 5 minutes, a pre-date.
Yeah,
oh, wow.
You just know, you know, that's it.
You just know, and you say, "Hey, thanks for the time, and appreciate it, and
good luck.
You know, take care."
Yeah, and I always tell singles too. You know what? 50, and no need to take it personally if the person's not into you. I know it's hard; it's easier said than done, but. You know, 50% chance. Not everybody's going to like you, and that's okay. It doesn't
True.
Mean there's something wrong with you.
That's
yeah, it
right.
just means it's not a match. And I really
right.
start to help singles to reframe that into, this is not personal. It's just, it's like anything else. You have to find a match.
Exactly.
You
Two
know,
puzzle
you
pieces
could,
that
you
fit.
You could look at 10 houses, and maybe you'll only like one of them, and maybe not enough to put an offer on it because it's just not home for you. And it, same with the relationship. You're looking for something that feels like, you know, a home that you'd want to live in, a person that you'd really want to be with. Just like you're not going to like everyone. Everyone's not going to like you or feel like it's compatible.
Right.
Sure.
Exactly.
And that tends to really help people because not to feel depressed or so disappointed, because it's just a meeting. You're just going to see if you like it.
Exactly.
See if you like them and see if they like you. Maybe you won't like them either. And that puts things into perspective.
It's not a rejection. That's right.
Well, that kind of leads me to another question, Krista, is can you offer some things for a single person when they should end the dating relationship?
Yeah, you're dating for a while, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, I need to end this.
Well, I think that dating... relationships, dating goes through phases, and you're going through a discovery phase when you start. And I think at any point when you discover that there's a deal breaker, that's a good time to end it.
Right.
Like if, for instance, you have a hard line on no drugs,
mm-hmm.
and you
right.
find out that the person is a recreational user, even, you know, something
sure.
like marijuana, you know, and you just say that you can't have that in your life, and this person has been using marijuana for 20 years recreationally, you know, you just have to know what your deal breakers are
and stick with it
and end it.
That's it.
Definitely.
And
definitely.
That's why it's so important to know ahead of time what they are, so you're not in that situation going, oh, should I stay? Should I not go? I, you know, all that stuff.
Yeah,
you know.
It's really clear. And
mm-hmm.
so if you find, for instance, you have one of your requirements that's not going to be met, like you have a requirement for, let's just say you have a requirement for exclusivity in marriage, and you find out that this person is not committed, is not going to commit, is not interested in that.
Or maybe wants an open relationship, which is different. It's sure. just
right,
different.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Or wants kids or doesn't want kids and you do. And you just find there's some, I call it, you know, unsolvable problem. I think I learned that from David. An yes. unsolvable problem that cannot be negotiated.
Period.
Gotcha.
Exactly.
And you just have to let go and say, you know what, I'm okay with me and I'm okay with just letting this go and being okay with what I want and just move on to the next.
Exactly. Krista, we have to wrap up. So how can people get in touch with you if they want to enroll in your coaching program?
They can call me mm-hmm. at 754-234-6991. That's 754-234-6991. If they want to check out more of what I'm offering, they can go to healingcouch.com, healingcouch.com.
Thank you,
that's
Krista.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being on.
This is a lot of great information for the dating people out there, all the singles, so... Fantastic.
I wish everyone a lot of luck and hope they can find the love of their life like you guys did and like I did.
Exactly.
Awesome. Thank
you.
So much. We'll
Thank you.
We'll be back after these commercials.
Bye.